Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is July 15th, 2018. Today is the eighth Sunday after Pentecost. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-051. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Our pastor is the Reverend John H. Pollock. Our organist is Greg Nolte. Flowers on the chancel stands are to the glory of God, from Nelson Kloppenstein in loving memory of Ruth and Nelson's anniversary. Visit us next in a couple weeks. Well, coming up this Friday on the 20th of July, Clark County Fair. We have a booth in the Mercantile Building the 20th through the 27th. Please come visit us. Food pantry is Wednesdays, 9 o'clock to 10:45. Outreach store is Monday through Friday, 9:30 to 1, closed on Thursday. Rainbow table is every Friday from noon to 1.
Thank you.
and also with you.
This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia.
We'll be doing the readings.
A reading from Amos. This is what the Lord God showed me. The Lord was standing beside a wall built with a plumb line. With a plumb line in his hand, the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? Then I said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, see, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again pass them by. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste. And I will raise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, said to King Jeroboam of Israel, saying, Amos has conspired against you in the very center of the house of Israel. The land is not able to bear all his words. For thus Amos has said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel must go into exile, away from his land. And Amaziah said to Amos, O seer, go, flee away to the land of Judah. Earn your bread there, and prophesy there. But never again prophesy at Bethel, for it is the king's sanctuary, and it is the temple of the kingdom. Then Amos answered Amaziah, I am no prophet, nor a prophet's son, but I am a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore trees. And the Lord took me from following the flocks, and the Lord said to me, go prophesy to my people Israel, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Faithful people and to those who turn their heart to you.
righteousness shall look down from heaven.
The Lord will indeed grant prosperity, and our land will yield its increase.
Righteousness shall go before the Lord, and shall prepare for the God of heaven.
Who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ, we also obtain an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were first to set our hopes on Christ, might live for the praise of his glory. In him, you also, when you have heard the words of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit, that is the pledge of our inheritance toward the redemption as God's own people to the praise of his glory, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
First of all, reminder that
not, as you enter sanctuary, just come on up to the chancellor and just move on the steps, two steps there in front of the altar before the service or after the service begins. And of course, same announcement I've been sharing with you for weeks now. Fair is coming up. We still have a couple of places where we need someone to watch our booth. So the sign-up sheet's outside Sherilyn's office. So if you would like to sign up, please do so. Let us now sing Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, hymn number 807, in the back of your room.
But today, in our society, there oftentimes can be a problem.
putting God first and not using the same thing. But they do have all the other, on your father and mother, not kill, adultery, steal, lie, and covet. So John had been attacking Herod, the son of Herod the Great, and his wife, who was Herodias. The reason he was attacking them was because the Jewish law said that when a woman was divorced from a man, that especially the brother of that husband, or brother of the former husband, could not marry the woman for himself. And this is exactly what Herod had done. Philip, his brother, had been married to Herodias. They were divorced. Now Herod has married Herodias, and every time John sees them, he reminds them of the sin that they had committed. And so it didn't matter if it was a king and queen or a preaching aroused so much hatred that it led to his murder. And we just see a similar, maybe not quite as drastic, but we see a similar reaction in society today when the church stands up and proclaims the truth. When the church stands up and calls sin, sin, as it's supposed to, we get blowback. We get reprisals from society because they don't want to hear that sense. And so truth can cause us trouble, but we're still supposed to be true. Some of the ways that you get in trouble for telling the truth is, first of all, by exposing sin. As we read in our gospel lesson for today, for John had been saying to Herod, "It is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife." It is not lawful. That means it is not right. Right is right. Wrong is wrong. Now you can try to change it and go call something else, but it's still all right. It's just like if you're going in the wrong direction trying to get home. And you're supposed to be going north, but you call it south. But you're going south. Well, just because you call south north doesn't make it right. You're not going to get home because you're going down the wrong path. So that is the purpose of the church, is to put that correction on society. Remember, Jesus told us we were to be that city shining on a hill which cannot be hid. We're to be that light in a darkened room. And so we have that responsibility. Even though we sin too, but we recognize that we sin and we repent of that sin, we still have to confront society when it sins and when it begins to totally ignore what is right and wrong. Today, what society needs to do all too often is call sin a choice. I can choose whether to obey this or that. But we've gotten into this big thing about people's rights, about personal freedom. But there, for there to be a society, to be a civilization, people have to agree on certain rules and regulations of how to live. You have to have the same morals and same values if you're going to be a productive civilization, a productive society. And for the first 200 or so years of our nation, we had common values, common morals. They were based on the Judeo-Christian heritage. People recognized that sin was sin, and right was right, and wrong was wrong. But now we have people who want to say, well, you make up your own rules, make up your own morals, make up your own values. But if everybody does that, we have nothing but complete chaos. Everybody will be stepping on everybody else, and we'll get back to the stronger survival. We'll get back to that period between the fall of Rome and the Renaissance, when the basic rule of Western civilization was the stronger survival. Might makes right. You had the might, you determined what was right. If you didn't have the might, you had no say. So that was one thing that our nation was bent on, the idea that we could speak up, and we could challenge our government and our society to do things for our when wrong was being called right and right was being called wrong. So, to get in trouble for telling the truth, then one way is by exposing sin, just what John the Baptist was doing. The second is like it in that you condemn sin. You hate the sin, but love the sinner. That was a popular mantra in the 80s. Love the sinner, but hate the sin. And that's the way it's still. When the church condemns sin, it's not condemning a person. It's calling on them to look at themselves and realize that they're violating God's law and they need to come back and repent. They need to repent, and repent, of course, it leads to salvation. But without repenting, there is no salvation. That was one of the justifications that Martin Luther used for supporting capital punishment. The idea that God had given the power of the sword to government, that is, the power to execute. He said, a person commits a crime and they may not repent until they are faced with the fact that they are looking at execution. He said, then the person, more times than not, will repent and receive absolution and receive assurance of heaven. Their physical life will end on this earth, yes, but their eternal life, soul, will not perish. Some of you may remember in the 90s a movie that was made, it was supposed to be an anti-capital punishment movie, but actually it made the point that Luther was making. I forget the name of it now, but it was about a condemned prisoner down in Louisiana, and Susan Train played the nun, this nun that began ministering to him, and he kept denying what he had done. He kept denying the murder, he kept denying his involvement, he kept saying no, and the nun knew he was not telling the truth. Finally, when his execution date was set, it got to be about a week or so before his execution, he finally broke down and confessed to the nun that he had committed the murder. Confessed everything he had done and sought absolution. So when he went to the gas chamber or whatever it was Louisiana did back when this took place, of course the movie was in the 90s, so the events took place earlier in the 70s. The point he saw was this man repented when facing death. Had he been given life in prison or paroled after 20 years, he probably never would have been. But he went to the death chamber assured and confident that he could do it. That is why it is the church's responsibility to call sin sin and not call it a change in our society or a choice that you can make for your own and have what rules you want, and there are different rules from somebody else. And so we repent, repenting we receive salvation. Repenting we are guaranteed of salvation. But people come along and tell the church, well, we shouldn't do that. There's a difference in condemning sin and judging somebody and their eternal soul. But we have the responsibility as citizens to sit on a jury and deliberate a person's fate, whether they're innocent or guilty, depending on the evidence. A judge has the responsibility of setting a sentence on that person, condemning them to life imprisonment or life 25 years to life or whatever, possibly parole after 15 years, whatever. That's the judge. Responsibility to judge that person and what their penalty. You're not judging an individual's soul. You're not judging whether they are going to heaven or hell. That is what Jesus is talking about when he says, judge not and be not judged. Because the Pharisees had this horrible practice of condemning people, judging people, because they did not fulfill the law to the letter like they did. And so people like the fishermen and the shepherds and the tanners become self-righteous and say, well, so-and-so is not a Christian because they don't act like I do. Or so-and-so doesn't really believe because this or that. When Jesus is talking, we can't do that as a judge. It's up to God to judge whether we're going to heaven or hell. It's up to the church to call people to repentance, to call people back to God, and to call people they haven't had a relationship with God to now have a relationship with God through their faith in Jesus Christ. Jesus establishes that relationship. A father was talking to his son, and he said to him, son, I want an explanation, and I want the truth. The son replied to the father, Dad, you can't have it both ways.
The word grudge means to
she could not pay. She did not have the power to do so. Why didn't she have the power to do so? We read it in the next verse. Because Herod, her husband, feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man. The word fear means to be terrified or cause to run away. That's what effect John had on Herod. The problem was Herod did not stand up to his wife. He let his wife influence for the name. John knew, or Herod knew John was a righteous and holy man. That means an innocent or just man. That's what righteous means. We're righteous before God because of Jesus Christ. We're innocent of our sin before God because of Jesus Christ, because we're washed in the blood of the Lamb. The word holy means to be sanctified, to be set apart. So the word sanctified means you're set apart. We are set apart from the world to fulfill that job that was first given to the Hebrew children when they made the covenant with God at Mount Sinai, became his chosen people, and that was to be a light to the nations of the world. And they were supposed to show the world how God really wanted to live in relationship with us and one another. But after rebelling and after exile and so forth, they became inclusive instead of exclusive. They just thought of themselves as the only ones who would be saved, the only ones that God cared about. Gentiles, God didn't care about the Gentiles, so I should die. Unfortunately, sometimes we have that attitude in the church. We think, well, we're saved, so that's all that's important. Or when we talk about reaching other people with the gospel, hear the attitude of, well, the times of the service are on the board outside. They can see what time the church comes. If they want to come, they can walk in the door. Yet time and time again, it's been proven that people come to church when they're invited by someone. I gave you the example last week where our little son Jordan, this fellow worker of his, invited him to church. Now, he was on the church staff. So, we have been set apart to share the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, which involves telling the truth. Sometimes the truth calls us to be imperfect. Sometimes you have to pay a price for telling the truth. But if we're telling the truth of Jesus Christ, it is all worth it. And then we read how Herod kept him safe. That means to keep him from perishing, to guard him, to rescue him, to keep him together. So he kept him safe. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed. That is not to understand, to not know exactly what's going on. Yet he heard him gladly. Heard him gladly. See, there's people today in our society that hear the gospel gladly. They don't let you talk to them about it. But they just won't take it next step to commit their life to Jesus Christ. And that's what we have to step in. Give them that urge. Come with me. Come and see me. Come and hear about the Lord Jesus Christ and what he can do for you and do for your life. And how he can take away your fears and your troubles. All of us have gone through difficulties in our lives. We've gone through tragedies. We've lost people we love. Have you ever stopped to think how in the world does someone go through that who doesn't have faith in Jesus Christ? If they believe that life is just life and that's it, how do they find it? How do they ever get over it? Whereas we have that assurance that we will see that person again and even that Jesus is preparing a place for us in his sight. We have that promise of we'll join that great cloud of witnesses and encourage those we leave behind to continue their race of life and pick themselves up and keep going. So it is important that we tell the truth in the matter of privacy. Certain areas of the world are very dangerous to proclaim the truth of Jesus Christ. Places in Africa, in the Middle East, in Indonesia, even in South America, can be very dangerous to proclaim the truth. But that's what we're called to do. And Jesus promises us he will be with us, promises us that if we are martyred, peace of God, which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.
Have mercy on those who carry heavy burdens.
care and grace, look to you for relief and peace, and wait in hope for the final healing of the resurrection through Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Join these our prayers and praise for those of your faithful people of every time and every place, and unite them in the ceaseless petitions of our great high priest, until he comes again in great power and glory as victorious Lord of all. Through him, with him, and in him, and the unity of the Holy Spirit, our honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
further emergency of the end. I gave him to supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave his gold to drink, saying, this cup is new covenant in my bloodshed to you for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again.
O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as a body of Christ for the world. Bring new life into us. Send us forth burning with justice, peace, and love. Come, Holy Spirit. With St. John the Baptist, our holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, with praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come to the banquet, for all is now.
Thank you.
Amen.
Let us pray. God of abundance, with his bread of life and cup of salvation, you united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world, and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our celebration of Go My Children with my blessing, hymn number 543, and a back of your worship. Hymn number 543.
That concludes our Sunday service. Join us next Sunday at the drive-in at 8 o'clock, the Melody Cruise Inn on East 40, east of Springfield, or at 10:30 here at St. John's in the Sanctuary at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Join us this Friday and the following week at the Clark County Fair in the Mercantile Building. St. John's Food Pantry is open Wednesday 9 to 10:45. The outreach door is open 9:30 to 1. Monday through Friday, closed on Thursday, and the Rainbow Table is every Friday from noon to 1. Everyone is welcome. Go in peace.